Well, it seems impassable. My way seems like there's no way to pass over. Jesus said, let's pass over and go to the other side. They began to believe there's no way to do that. Yes, they did. They woke him up trying to talk some sense into him. Don't you see the storm? Don't you care? You're sleeping through this. Something's wrong with you. You must not understand the severity of the situation. You couldn't sleep through this. If you understood what we know, we're fishermen. We know water. We know boats. We're in trouble. And he just got up, took care of the situation, then took care of them. How is it that you have no faith? Why are you so fearful? Come on now. Our very lives are in jeopardy, and you're asking us why we're fearful? Well, you're looking at the natural. You're not looking at the supernatural. Why are you fearful? Oh, come on now. Jesus, come on. That's not a reasonable question. Anybody with any sense would know we're in trouble out here. Well, I wish you'd get some spiritual sense and be transformed by the renewing of your mind. When you're transformed, you act different, you talk different, you look different, you walk different, you think different. And you're not fearful when everybody else is. And they'll consider that you're out of your mind. Well, he doesn't understand the severity of the situation. I understand completely, but I believe that it shall be even as God said, as it was told me. Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Well, he said, let's pass over and go to the other side. When it got to where it looked like their way was impassable, they needed to trust what he said. Your road may seem impassable, but he's made a way up ahead. Why? How's the way? Well, one way is rebuke the wind and the wave and the sea. One way is keep going and touch your feet in the water. He said, go. Well, let's get up and go. Well, it looks like it's not working. Well, don't go by what it looks like. Don't sit down and wait for God to do it in God's timing. People are sitting and waiting. And well, when God gets ready, soon as he parts that water, it's like the fireplace saying, or you're saying to the fireplace, you give me some fire, I'll put in some wood. Some people have the cart before the horse. With God, it's believing it first. People want to see it. They'll ask you to pray until they see it. Because after all, they don't see it yet or feel it yet, so keep praying. I want to ask them, what scripture you believe in? You're asking me for prayer based on what scripture? And when are you going to believe that it's so? Well, I want to ask people, and they say, well, pray for me about what and what for and what scripture do you have? Based on what scripture and what are you going to believe? What's going to change? What's going to be different about your believing after you know I've prayed? What's different? You've asked me to pray. Now, what's different? You're going to go ask 15 more people to pray, aren't you? And you're going to keep asking until you feel and see the change, aren't you? See, there's not a speck of faith in that. There's not even an ounce. There's not a gram of faith in that. And God's a faith God. He's not another kind. He's a faith God. You might get things in the natural from the natural world, but you don't get things from God based on natural. He's supernatural. And supernatural believes something that it doesn't see. That's why it's supernatural. If you waited till you saw it, that'd be natural. Your eyes are natural. Your faith is supernatural. And when the natural won't work, because all hope is gone, there's no way, there's no help, there's no hope, your road is impassable. The only help you have is supernatural. You'll have to know how faith works. And it believes something before it sees it, before it feels it. And it's based on scripture. I have it now. All things are possible. But that doesn't mean it'll happen to me until I believe. It's possible to me. And it's based on the word I receive. Not somebody's prayers necessarily, but prayer in line with the word. The word of God is what puts us over. If I could just get, you know, I wish Brother Hagin could pray for me. Well, it's not Brother Hagin that puts you over. Well, I wish Brother Tony would just pray for me. Well, it's not Brother Tony that puts you over. It's the word of God. What scripture are you believing and asking him to believe? Maybe he's developed in faith, but it's the word of God that's going to put us over. So what scripture are you believing? You ask people that, they don't have one. Well, I just thought you'd pray. Well, the Bible says, ask and ye shall receive. Where is that? Why? Well, come on now. I don't know. I've heard that it's in there. They'll use that verse about anything. What about the verse that you ask and receive not? Huh? Is that in there? I just believe if you believe it, God will do it. They believe with their head in natural things. I just believe for $10 million by next Friday. Well, see, you don't. You don't believe that. I believe God can do that. That's hope. That's not believing. One reason I want to ask people what they believe based on scripture. Brother Tony, would you pray for me? Who do you want me to pray to? Well, I want you to pray to God. Well, what has he said that gives you any basis to believe that praying to him about anything? Do you have a job? Yeah, I work for that big company down there. I want you to go ask your boss to give me $1 million. I don't know that he has $1 million. How much do you think he has? Well, he probably has 1,000 in the corporate checking account. Oh, it may be 10,000. Go ask him to write me a check for $10,000. What basis do I have to ask that person to go to their boss and do that? And do I have any reason to believe that it'll happen? If they were to go to their boss and ask, I know a man named Tony McCanless. He asked me to ask you to write him a check for $10,000. Is there any reason for me to believe that'll happen? Even if they go do it, is there any reason for me to believe that'll happen? Let me ask you. Now, I'm asking this person who I know, they like me, I like them. They've got a good job. They've got a relationship. They know the boss personally. And I'm asking him to go ask his boss to write me a check for $10,000. And he'll do it. He's just going to go right in Monday morning and ask for an appointment. Can I come see you? Well, I'm busy. I got a busy schedule, but I've got 5 minutes. That's all it'll take. So they go into the office of the boss Monday morning for 5 minutes. I know a man named Tony McCanless. He asked me to come ask you to write him a check for $10,000. Do I have any basis to believe I'll get it? Do I? Even if he goes and asks, and he's got a good relationship with that man. They like one another, and he's worked there for 15 years. They even have, sometimes they play golf together on the weekends. I mean, they're not only they work together, but he even likes them so well, they play golf together sometimes on the weekend. And he's asking him for me. I know a man named Tony McCanless. He asked me to come ask you to write him a check for $10,000. And he goes and asks him. Do I have any basis to believe I'll get it? Why do I not have any basis? I've never heard him promise me $10,000. I've never heard him promise him $10,000 for a friend. I don't have any basis. All I'm doing is hoping. God is not a hope God. Hope's important, but faith is the substance of hope. As important as hope is, never lose your hope. And hope should be based on the knowledge of the word. It's a confident expectation. But God's a faith God. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. Faith comes by hearing. Ask in faith, nothing wavering, James said. Hebrews 11:6 says it's impossible to please him without faith. Romans 10:17 says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. James 1 says that ask in faith. Well, I need wisdom. Ask God. Is there any requirement or any stipulation or any condition? Well, sure. Ask in faith. Nothing wavering. Well, what do you mean faith? Faith is the substance of the hope. It's the evidence. You have something you don't see, and it's based on the word. Well, if I've never heard that man promise $10,000 to me or to a friend that comes and asks, if I've never heard him, I don't have any basis to believe it. People do God that way all the time. All the time. Would you pray and ask God for this and that for me? So-and-so is sick. Would you pray for our healing? My wife, my daughter, my aunt, my relative, my neighbor needs healing. Would y'all pray? What's the basis? Who am I praying to? Well, God. What's the basis for me to go to God for you? Any more than you go to your boss for me. You're going to your boss and asking him for $10,000. I'm going to my God and asking him for healing. What's your basis to believe it? Just because I ask? You got a good relationship with your boss? I believe he'll give me $10,000 if you ask him. What if he doesn't? Well, you know, you'll get what you believe. Believing God must be based on his word, or you're not believing him. You might be believing something, but you're not believing him. You might be believing somebody or your own thought in your own head, but you're not believing him unless you know his word. That's why faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word of God, not the word of somebody who said something about God or some thought you had about God. Somebody could spread a rumor around. Brother Tony said, whoever goes to the service, you know, any Sunday morning, if you come to the service, he'll give you $100. They could spread that around. Let's up it. Let's make it $1,000. Anybody who comes, Brother Tony is going to give them $1,000. We'd have more people here, wouldn't we? Well, let's just say they believe what they hear. Somebody spreads that around and they believe it. They believe the rumor. Now, I never said it, but somebody goes and spreads that. Brother Tony said he'll give $1,000 to everybody who comes Sunday morning. And they believe that. Well, I believe you. You're saying he said that. All right. I believe that. And they come. We'd have more people here, wouldn't we? And they, what are you here for? Well, we're here for our $1,000. They come right up to me boldly and say, I'm here for my $1,000. What $1,000? Well, that person said, if I came, you'd give me $1,000. I'm going to ask them, when did I say it? See, you're believing that person about me, but you're not believing me. And faith in me has to come from my word, not what somebody said about me. You don't have any faith in me until you heard me say it. My integrity is not on the line until you've heard me say it. And you just go sit down because you're going to go without. I'm not going to do it based on what they said. Amen. People do God that way all the time. Will you ask him to heal me? Well, what's the basis? Well, I just believe if you ask him, he'll do it. Well, you got a good relationship with your boss at work? I want you to go ask him to write me a check. I just believe if you'll ask him, he'll do it. I'm going to go with you. That man is going to ask me, why are you expecting this? When did you hear me say it? People need to know why they're asking for prayer, because God's a faith God, and faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. They need to have scripture. He sent his word and healed, not prayer after all. He sent his word and healed. I stress this. It needs to be stressed. I see it virtually everywhere I go. The imbalance. Pray, 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 pray. They'll send me a request. Brother Tony, would you pray? I don't get many requests. Brother Tony, would you give me a Bible verse? Here's the situation I'm in. Would you give me some scripture for me to meditate on and read and believe? I don't get many of those requests. I'm facing some financial difficulties. I wish you'd just give me some financial scriptures so I can meditate on them, dwell on them, focus on them. I don't get many of those requests. I get prayer requests. And I'll ask them, what scripture do you have? They don't know. But they're asking for prayer. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me to pray. Did he say that? What's he anointed me to do? When he sent the, after he was raised from the dead, and he's speaking to the 12, and then he said, make disciples and tell them to do everything I've commanded you to do. So he's spreading it on, you know, passing it on. But in Mark chapter 16, he said, go into all the world and pray. Is that what he said? Go into all the world and pray. Did he say that? No, he said, preach. In verse 20, it says the Lord went with them. They went and preached everywhere. Did it say they prayed everywhere? No, it says they preached. They preached everywhere, and the Lord working with them and confirming their prayers. Does it say the Lord confirmed their prayers? I believe in prayer, but if you're going to get something from God, and that is who we're praying to, then it'll have to be based on his word. He will keep his word. God will keep his word. His word you need to receive. You must. Because he said it, all things are possible to them that believe. Believe what? His word. Not what somebody said about him. Not what you thought about him. Well, I just believe if I ask, I'll receive. That scripture is in line with other scriptures. Ask in line with his word. Because James also said, you ask and don't receive. So sometimes you ask and you don't receive. And the reason is, it wasn't spiritual. It was emotional or flesh, to consume it upon your own lust. The motive was wrong. Well, I just believe if I ask, I'll get it. No, there's other scripture that says you won't. If the motive's wrong. But if it's to receive based on his word and to praise him, bless him, glorify him, give the testimony. If my heart doesn't condemn me, I have confidence. If I ask anything according to his will, this is 1 John 5. If it's according to his will, he hears me. And that's his word. 1 John chapter 5 says, if I ask anything according to his will, then he hears me. And then whatever I ask, I know I have the petitions I desired. So if you go slow with some people, you blow them out of the water and offend them. On a few occasions, that might be what you ought to do. But often, if not usually, you go slow. Somebody says, pray. Well, you pray because they're asking. Really, you're showing that you care. They want to know that. But little by little by little, you teach. Brother Tony, will you pray? I usually do. Do we get it? Usually not. Not supernatural. If it's in the natural realm, they might get better because they followed the doctor's instructions. But the supernatural comes from the supernatural. Supernatural results come from the supernatural world and the supernatural realm. God's supernatural, and he's a faith God. He's not any other kind of God. He's a faith God. That is the kind of God he is. When Jesus cursed the fig tree and they marveled, he said and called attention to how God operates all of the time. This is how God operates all the time. He said, Mark 11:22, have faith in God. If you look at the Greek and the original text, it's the faith of God. The faith of God. That is the kind of faith that God uses. Well, Jesus spoke to the fig tree. The tree obeyed him. They marveled because it's supernatural. Peter marveled how soon the fig tree. The disciples marveled. Peter calling to remembrance and, Master, behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away. Same stories in Matthew 21, also Mark 11. But Jesus said immediately, you know, Jesus wasn't surprised. They were. They marveled how soon the fig tree was withered. Jesus didn't. He wasn't surprised. Peter calling him to remembrance said, Master, behold. He's asking the Lord to look at that fig tree. The fig tree which you cursed is withered away. And Jesus said, well, would you look at that? Wow. This works. Wow. Wow. This really does work. Did he say that? No. He immediately said, this is the way God operates all the time. All the time. And you can operate this way all the time. I mean, not just this fig tree. Matthew 21, he said, you'll not only do this, but you could make it work on something that seems insurmountable like that mountain. Impossible. Because all things are possible to him that believeth. If you believe in your heart, not doubt in your heart. That's what he means. Doubt not in the heart, because that's where the believing is. For with the heart man believeth. That's what he said. Romans says, by the Spirit of God, same Spirit. Jesus said one thing. Paul said another thing. They're both saying the same thing. For with the heart man believeth. And then Jesus in Mark 11:23 said, if you don't doubt in your heart, your head can fight you. One thing people need to know is you can doubt in your head and still believe in your heart and it'll work for you. But you're believing that it's in line with God. God's a faith God, and he believes something that he doesn't see. Jesus cursed the fig tree one time, walked away, and believed that was enough. What people do today is they'll curse it, look at it, curse it, look at it, curse it, look at it, and ask somebody else, come cut it down for them. And then say, God did it. Well, God sent me somebody to cut it down. And they'll justify and figure out a way to make it look God. Jesus didn't curse it, and then when no one was looking, put some Roundup on it. Well, God supplied the Roundup. He gave us understanding and knowledge how to make it, and I just happened to find some. God did that. We do hear that all the time. They'll figure out a way to make it God. Sounds to me like you did it. Somebody told me they prayed for a car and got a car. God gave me a car. I asked them more questions. They went to the bank and got a loan. God may help you pay for it, but he didn't get you that car. You got the car. Well, he gave me the loan. Did you qualify? Let me go talk to the bank officer. You've had four bankruptcies in the last 3 years and you don't have a job and you're in debt, but he gave you the loan anyway. No, you qualified. That's not supernatural. That's natural. God may get involved, but that's not supernatural. That's natural. Can somebody say amen? People want to make things look like they're supernatural. If you keep doing that, when the natural won't work and you have to have the supernatural, you'll do without. Because you won't learn the difference. I see that virtually everywhere I go. People don't know the difference between the natural and the supernatural, and they're busy calling things supernatural that aren't. It's not taught. And just they for their own ego, or I don't know, they just want to somehow ascribe it to God. Well, look what happened. God did that. Praise God, praise God, praise God. God did that. You ask questions, get details, it's natural. I don't see anything supernatural about it. Well, Jesus cursed the fig tree, and when no one was looking, he put some Roundup on it, and the next day it was withered from the roots and dried up. God did that. No, the Roundup did that, and Jesus did not do that. He cursed it and walked away. It's good enough. He spoke his word of authority based on the will of God. And then they marveled, and he said, well, this is the way God operates all the time. Well, I'm going to do that. Do it based on his word. James said, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss. Make sure the motive is right. Make sure you're asking according to his will, because then he hears you. Make sure it's by the word and by the spirit. And then with bold authority and conviction of your spirit, believe that you receive when you pray. Say it. Don't doubt in your heart. Jesus said, you'll have what you say. Amen. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Brother Tony, I'm here for my $1,000. When did you hear me say it? Well, I never heard you say it. Then go sit down. Well, I'm just believing that God will heal me. When did you hear him say it? Well, the preacher said to everybody that needs healing, come for prayer. Line up. I'll rub your head, you rub my head. He said, come. Now, God will do some signs and wonders, especially in the world, and you can carry some baby Christians. Sometimes people get healed in that atmosphere, and the preacher doesn't even know why. Because this one gets healed and this one doesn't. Well, I don't understand. God's ways are past finding out. Well, that one was a baby Christian, or sometimes the waters are troubled and moved, and whoever steps in gets healed, gifts of the Spirit operate. But everyone can receive healing through the word. Teach the word, preach the word, let people have faith in the word, and then come in faith and learn how to believe you receive. And that moment, I've got it now. Don't go by what you see and feel and what your body says. I have it now. Praise God. And walk away. Or in your wheelchair. Maybe you can't walk. Then roll away. I have it now. Or they have to carry you. They carried you in, they carry you out. But I have it. I have it based on the word of God. He laid hands on me. And the Bible says, lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. So I'm recovering. He anointed me with oil. And the Bible says the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And the Lord raises them up. This has been done to me. I've been anointed with oil, and the prayer of faith has been prayed. I've got it. And go your way, believing and praising God for it. That's faith. Faith is the substance of the hope. You don't have it yet. You're still hoping. But the faith is the substance that says you have it by faith. It's the evidence that you don't see it, or that you have what you don't see. It's the evidence of things not seen. And by faith, I have it. Not going to keep trying to get it. We need to cooperate with faith when we're dealing with people that have already been prayed for. Somebody's prayed for in the Sunday service. You visit them on a Monday, and they still look sick. Well, I'm going to pray for you. What for? Cooperate with the faith they already released yesterday. Don't undo it. Yeah, but Brother Tony, they were sick. I wanted to pray for them. What prayer did you pray? Well, I prayed the Lord would heal them. You undid the prayer that was prayed yesterday. If they received that, and then maybe they were polite and they just let you pray on, but they didn't receive it because they didn't agree that it needed to be prayed. And they're just being polite, not wanting to hurt your feelings. But we ought to cooperate with the faith that someone's already released. You were prayed for yesterday. You still look sick today? Well, I'm just praising God with you. I'm just praising God with you that it's in you working. Let's just join hands and just praise God together right now for your healing. You do that. You keep doing that and you'll see results because God is faithful. Can somebody say amen? Say it out loud. God is faithful. Say it again. God is faithful. Say it again. God is faithful. He'll do what he said he'll do. You have what he said you have. You are who you are and what you are, he said about you. And you'll be what he said you'll be because he's faithful. And he's got the power to make it good. I could promise somebody $10 million, but not have the power to make it good. My promise is no good. God's promise is good. He has the power to make it good. The silver and the gold are His. The cattle on 1,000 hills. He's got the power to make it good. All things are possible to him that believeth. Why? Because with God, there's nothing impossible with him. He's got the power to make it good. Besides which, I've been born again. There's a new spirit in this body than what used to be here years ago. God did that. How did he put in a new spirit in this body and the body didn't miss a breath? Doctors, if they'd been examining that moment, they wouldn't have missed a heartbeat. Well, his body's functioning right on. Because you take the spirit out of the body will die. God took out the old spirit, put in a new spirit, and the heartbeat didn't miss. And yet it's a brand new spirit inside this body. How did God do that? And people are they're struggling trying to receive a new pancreas. Are you a Christian? You've already got a greater miracle than a new pancreas. They're struggling trying to get a new liver. The doctor says, my liver doesn't function. Well, get a new one. Well, that just must take a lot of faith. Are you a Christian? Yeah. Then you've already got enough faith. You got a new spirit. Why can't you get a new liver? Is one more difficult to God? One's harder. Jesus asked the question, whether is easier, to forgive sins or to say, rise, walk? Which one's easier? To Jesus, they're the same. If I can tell him his sins are forgiven, I can tell him his body as well. And if he'll believe it and act on it, it'll be that way. He saw their faith. He saw their faith. He saw their faith. It's the people that were scrutinizing and examining and analyzing and that he had to explain things to. That man wasn't struggling with it. It's the people, the Pharisees and the doctors of the law. They're struggling with this. Well, I'm going to tell him he's well. I told him his sins were forgiven. Really, Jesus did that just to stir something because he knew their thoughts. Well, one is just as easy or just as hard. Well, I just believe if I ask God to forgive me, he does. Then why do you struggle getting a new gallbladder or liver or pancreas or hip or anything else? One's just as easy as the other, and you've already received a new spirit. How much faith did that take? Well, I just believed his word. I confessed with my mouth the Lord Jesus, believed in my heart God raised him from the dead. I just took him at his word, and he's faithful, and I've been born again. Then take him at his word for healing. It's not any more difficult to God, and you've got the faith to receive it if you've heard that healing's yours. Can somebody say amen? Said out loud, God is faithful. I have healing. I'm a child of God. I have a new spirit. God did that. Healing is not any harder. I have healing. God did that. By whose stripes I was healed. God did that. Jesus did that. Himself took my infirmities. He bore my sicknesses. Jesus did that. I'm well. Hallelujah. God did that. Say it again. God is faithful. Turn and tell your neighbor, God is faithful. Tell your other neighbor, God is faithful. There's a lady in England, young lady. She was a partially paralyzed, couldn't walk from the waist down, partially paralyzed, had some feeling, she could have some sensation, but couldn't walk. And she was reading in the Bible in James chapter 5 about, is there any sick among you? Call for the elders, they'll come and pray and anoint with oil. The prayer of faith will save the sick. The Lord will raise them up. So she called the church that she was familiar with, had attended, knew about her. And the pastor didn't believe it. Didn't believe that. We don't do that around here. Well, somehow or another, she called back, or somehow or another got the assistant pastor. And he said he would come. So he came, anointed her with oil, according to James 5. And then she didn't feel any better, look any better. But she would say, well, this has been done. She'd put her finger on the scripture there in James chapter 5, 14, 15. She'd say, this has been done to me. People would visit, relatives and friends. And she'd say, you know, get my Bible. Look there, open to James chapter 5. Look at that scripture in verse 14. Verse 15, she'd say, this has been done to me. Now she's still paralyzed, still crippled, still can't walk. But she'd say, this has been done to me. I've been anointed with oil. This says the Lord raises me up. The prayer of faith heals. That word save means heals. This has been done. She put it in the past tense because it had been done. The Lord raises me up. 6 months later, she had sort of a seizure and got worse, doubled up with pain. Her mother was attending to her and caring for her, and she would just walk out of the room crying. Lord, please heal my daughter. Why don't you heal my daughter? Allowing my daughter to have such suffering. This has been done to me. Anybody come over, she'd say, get my Bible. Open it to James 5, 14 and 15. Look at that. People in her area didn't even believe that. They didn't act on that. It says, call for the elders of the church, and they'll come, anoint with oil, and the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord raises them up. If they've committed sins, they'll be forgiven. She'd say, this has been done to me. Another 3 months went by, a total of 9 months. She's thanking God and praising God for her healing. This has been done. Jesus Christ appeared to her and said these words, if I remember the story correctly. He said, arise and this thy strength. And she got off that bed, totally well and completely healed. This has been done to me. She fought the good fight for 9 months. She called out. Now in England, they say, Mom, Mom. Her mother came to the door, opened the door and looked and saw her standing by the bed and fainted. True story. 9 months of her saying, this has been done to me. I've been anointed with oil. The prayer of faith has been prayed over me. The Bible says the Lord raises me up and heals. That word save in the Greek is also heals the sick. This has been done to me. She settled it. She settled it. She settled it. And she didn't have some unbelieving Pentecostals going around continuing to pray. Well, we're just going to pray for you. We're going to pray for you. We're going to pray for you. This has been done. Thank God with me. Thank God with me. Thank God with me. This has been done. Amen.